thank you very much for coming. I hope that my presentation will be at least partially so interesting as the preceding ones. According to its title, I will be talking today about non-conventional models of computation, both theory and Turing models, and about possible applications for models on mental or brain activities. And the first part of my presentation will be longer and will refer to computer science, to different types of computation. The second part will be a little bit shorter, we'll refer rather to cognitive science. And it will contain rather some preliminary remarks or intuitions from hard scientific results. At the very beginning, we should distinguish between Turing model computation and non-Turing models. The first one is conventional, is classical. According to its name, it is described formally by universal Turing machine formally, or other mathematically equivalent formalities. The computations compliant with this model are discrete. We can roughly say that they are digital, they are finite, so we can perform only finite number of operations in a finite time. They are non-random, and as I said before, non-interactive. This model are closest to computing practice because it describes at the very basic analytical level the way of processing data in digital computers. And what is important, this model is computationally limited. So there are some problems that we cannot solve under this model. The non-Turing models of computation are indicated here on the right side of the screen, are unconventional. They are described by different mathematical frameworks and or concepts, for example, by real numbers, not only integers, like in the case of Turing computation. Actually, most of them are not all of them, but most of them are some extensions of Turing model, extensions in that sense that some key features of this computation can be replaced by broader ones. Among them are continuous analog computations, models like the Shannon model or infinitistic or interactive. I will be talking about them later. These models are developed rather in theory. Maybe with one exception of real analog continuous machines that were constructed and used before the era of digital computing as early as in the 1940s, for example, by Vannevar Bush. And at the end, we should emphasize that these models are stronger than universal Turing machine, but maybe only in theory. So why these unconventional models are interesting for computer scientists and methodologists of this science? The answer was in the last row of the previous slide. And they are interesting because Turing model is computationally limited, so there are some problems uncomputable on this model. We can divide them into two groups. The first group contains problems that are uncomputable in practice, and they are solved because of lack of sufficiently good algorithms with appropriate computational complexity, for example, time complexity. So we know some algorithms, for example, brute force algorithms for solving this kind of problem, but in the case of large data, they are simply useless. The second group contains problems that are uncomputable in principle, And this kind of, these problems kind of are such a characteristic that there is no one universal algorithm for solving all the specific cases of this given problem. Typical problems that are on the table in practice, in two instances, traveling salesman problem on the left side of the screen, belonging to graph theory, SAT problem belonging to logic, or some issues related to finding winning strategies in some games like generalized chess. For example, the first problem, so traveling salesman problem is a problem of finding the shortest route between all the nodes visiting only once in a given graph, or you can say, referring to the name of this problem, finding the shortest route between all the cities interconnected in the network of different nodes with different lengths. So, the crucial property here is responsible for this kind of uncompatibility is time complexity. Examples of problems that are uncomputated in principle are plotting problem, dynamic equations problem, post-ordinance problem. They are all historical problems. Perhaps the most important and most historical one is the plotting problem of Turing machines. That was discovered by Turing and was described first in his famous paper on table numbers and its applications. And the crucial property here responsible for this kind of compatibility, more important from the point of view of the computation, is Hodgkin property. So each relevant algorithm, each algorithm you would like to use to solve such a kind of problems have a such property that we simply cannot check in a finite time if these algorithms will stop after performing finite number of steps or after a finite time. When we would like to overcome uncompatibility, as computer scientists, as even mathematicians interested in computer science, we can apply at least three strategies. First strategy consists in modifying the problem or simplifying it. For example, in the case of traveling salesman problem, we can find not the shortest route between the cities, but the route that is no longer when two shortest routes merge together. So for this simplified problem, we have some efficient algorithms, but we should emphasize that the original problem remains uncomputable. But we will achieve something following this strategy. The second strategy consists in dividing the problem into some sub-problems and choosing on specific subset of this sub-problem or specific sub-problem that is important for us from some practical point of view. For example, in the case of plotting problem, we can choose only specific subset of Turing machines and try to resolve this problem, try to find so-called local algorithm for solving plotting problem only for this subset. And it is possible. The last strategy, the most important here, is to change the model of computation. We can call this strategy a large caliber strategy. And this last method of strategy is directed to non-Turing models of computation. And when you would like to move from Turing to non-Turing, we can use another general strategy, rather natural, that consists in modifying some key features of Turing model. And these key features are discreteness, faithfulness, and randomness, closeness. For example, when we replace discreteness feature by the broad data continuity property feature, we will obtain one of the models of another continuous computation, for example, channel model. And under this model, we can process continuous signals, and at the level of the mathematical level of description, the signals are described in the use of real numbers, not only integers, as I said before. Okay, to briefly summarize in the first part of the presentation, you can say that non-Turing models are extensionally broader than Turing model, and that means that under these models you can maybe only in theory, but maybe we will find in future some systems, some inflow systems combined with model, but we can solve the broader class of problems. And examples of these models described in literature of so-called hypercomputation are continuous models, like mentioned your channel model, accelerated Turing machine as an example of infinitistic model, graphic Turing machine as an example of open system, etc. Okay, and this first part of my presentation refers to computer science. Now, I would like to move to cognitive science, and this transition is possible because of the formal nature of computer science. According to this formal nature, some basic concepts of computer science, like code, data, infrastructure, algorithm, different kinds of algorithms, computability, models of computation, etc., can be interpreted in different empirical domains, fields, for example, in the cognitive science domain. And when we refer this concept to mental activity, some our cognitive functions like perception, reasoning, or learning, we obtain a cognitive science or cognitivistic interpretation of these concepts. For example, if we take from AI a certain algorithm of learning artificial neural networks, to treat it as a mathematical object with some interesting mathematical properties, and when we interpret this algorithm as a model of human learning at the level of brain, we will obtain, doing that, we'll obtain some kind of cognitive interpretation of this computer science concept like learning algorithm. And to put it broadly, we can treat various models of computation like formal basis for building some partial models of the mind, partial, so we cannot model whole mind, entire mind, but we may model some partial ideas like perception, for example. When we focus on Turing model, we have Turing side models of partial Turing side models of mind that are at the very basic mathematical level explanation of description are equivalent to some Turing machine. In practice, in the context of constructing real machine, there are machines with finite date, not with infinite date, purely theoretical approach. But in other words, we can say that each program that describes Turing's time model can be presented or represented as a program for the universal Turing machine. And this Turing time models, we can maybe all of us agree that they are dominant. And this is due to the commonness or popularity of digital technologies and digital computers. These Turing time models are implemented by the use of different programs for digital computers. As you know, these programs are combined with Turing computation. And what is important, these models don't include only symbolic systems like rule-based expert system, for example, taken from AI, but also some connection systems based on artificial neural networks. This is the case because, almost all of neural networks are implemented in practice by programs for digital computers. So this is important. And these models are dominant, but this Turing style, but non-Turing, are interesting, especially for me. Are interesting firstly for computational reasons, and I have already talked about it. We want simply to invent some techniques to overcome uncomputability. But secondly, we are interesting for cognitive reasons, and that means that there are some properties of the human mind that enforce us to think that human mind doesn't work like Turing machine. And perhaps the most important properties mentioned are the possible analogicity of the brain. Continuity of nervous system, or the way of processing signal processing inside our brains, the creativity of the mind, and hence unproductivity of some mental actions, and maybe to implement or to achieve this property to our mind, we require some random events, also at the level of theory, random at the level of theory, some tools for describing processing occurring random events and processing them.
Okay.
So and was that I am okay. Like, how many minutes left?
You've stopped over 20 minutes, so otherwise you eat up our break.
So this is the last slide. That reasons due to maybe three properties, there is something to do for cognitive scientists. Because although some motivation for proposing and developing non-Turing computations originates from computer science, we simply would like to resolve some hard problems. All for that, cognitive science at the level of modeling, in the area of modeling, is important, and maybe cognitive scientists can or should even provide us some empirical justified why on the usefulness of certain types of hypercomputation, so non-Turing computation. And in this context, important for me question arises. If some non-Turing systems, like another continuous ones or infinitesimal ones, can serve not only as theoretical or formal models of some mental activities, maybe, or can they serve as real, physically implemented models of this minor activities, mental activities. Okay, so this is all I would like to say. Thank you very much.